Hi, my name is Paul Byrne. I am an Associate Professor of Planetary Science here in the Department of Marine, Earth and Atmospheric Sciences in the College of Sciences at NC State. So we see in the Star Wars movies that the planets all over the galaxy. And what's really interesting about Star Wars is that the kind of planets we see are beginning to look a little bit like the planets we now know are in existence in this solar system and in other planetary systems. All right, let's talk about cold planets. So there's a few we can talk about. There's Hoth, which we see in Empire Strikes Back, which looks to be completely covered in ice. There is Kijimi, which looks to be in the new movie, which at the very least has what looks like icebergs on it. There's Starkiller Base, which itself looks like a cold world. Well, it's worth talking about what cold worlds are. So one of the ways you get a planet that's cold is you put it relatively far from its sun, or you make that sun relatively weak. And it's possible that the entire planet could be covered in ice. In fact, there was a part of Earth's history we call Snowball Earth about 600 million years ago when we think most of Earth was covered in glaciers. And that was a function of how much volcanism was going on the planet at the time. So certainly you can get planets that are almost totally or completely covered in ice, and those planets may even have some life on them, although it's very, very difficult for life to endure in very cold conditions. Think the fact that we have creatures that go into hibernation like Arctic foxes and bears in places where it gets really cold on Earth. Okay, what about desert planets? Well, Star Wars universe is full of them. We have Tatooine, obviously, the one we saw originally. We've got Jakku, which we see in Force Awakens, and we've got Jedha, which we see in Rogue One. Now, those worlds look to be covered completely in desert, or at least the parts of those worlds we see from space. Is it possible to have a desert planet? Yeah, it is. And it's probable that you could actually get a desert planet that's completely desert. It might be cold desert at the poles and hot desert at the equator. But if a world doesn't have very much water, you're pretty much talking about getting desert conditions on the surface, and that's what Mars is like today. We call Mars a desert planet, because the definition of desert isn't necessarily full of sand, it's that you've got almost no water. And these worlds certainly look like places where water is a scarce resource. Think of Luke going to Toshi Station to get some power converters for the water farm. So in terms of looking at worlds made of sand, yeah, worlds like Tatooine, they're probably realistic. There are probably Tatooine-like worlds out there somewhere in space. Let's talk about Earth-sized worlds, and there's two we can talk about a lot. There's Naboo, which we see in the prequel trilogy, and then there's Coruscant, which we've seen really in the prequel trilogy and a little bit afterwards. What's interesting about these worlds is on the basis of the air the characters are breathing and the gravity they seem to be under, these worlds, Naboo and Coruscant, seem to be a lot like Earth, and they're Earth-like. Now, one of the things that characterizes Earth is the presence of what we call plate tectonics, where that outer shell is broken into plates and they jostle and move and some bits pull apart and some gets pushed together, but you get a huge amount of volcanic activity and a huge amount of tectonic activity in the form of earthquakes. Now, Naboo looks like a world that could be subject to those forces, tectonic and volcanic forces and earthquakes, and folks in a world like Naboo could absolutely learn to deal with it just like we do on Earth. But Coruscant is a world made of one giant city. And it's not clear to me, at least in the movies, as to how they managed both the heat coming out of the interior from volcanic activity and the prospect of jostling blocks and plates that might shake the buildings apart. Let's talk about vegetative worlds. Well, there's two big ones we can talk about. There's Yavin 4 and there's Endor, the forest moon of Endor, although I'm not sure if that's the name of the moon or the name of the planet that goes around. But either way, planets with huge expanses of forest or vegetative material, that's not in any way unrealistic, because we see that on Earth. We see huge areas of boreal forest, like we get here in North Carolina, or jungle. So the idea of what we see in those worlds being unrealistic, no. That's probably something we would get somewhere out in the galaxy around us. It's not clear whether or not they'd have cold poles and hot equators, but certainly at mid-latitudes, yeah, that's pretty realistic. What I think is really interesting about Star Wars is that when the first movie came out in 1977, we still did not know that there really were other planets outside of our own solar system. So what Star Wars showed us in 77 and in the earlier trilogies really turns out to be the truth in the galaxy around us.